Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome rising Sun recording artist Xavier.
Yeah. show I've done for, well, since a long time. Last night was the first one. In a while. Been over doing a TV show over in Hawaii. And it was great because the day I left, which was last November or something, the day I left Massachusetts, got on the plane and turned to 17 below at home. Called up my wife when I got there. She stayed home. And I said, "Hey, it's great here. How you doing?" There was a long silence that could only be interpreted as, "Fuck you." I didn't mean to be explicit, but you know, you can't lie about these things. It was 100 degrees difference between us. Cool. So anyway, I was over there, you know, and I haven't been doing a bunch of shows or nothing, and for the first time in, I don't know, I can't remember when. And so there I was last night trying to play and stuff, you know, and suddenly realized my fingers weren't hitting the keyboard like on the, you know, on the guitar. I couldn't figure it out, and I suddenly realized I had fingernails. And I didn't think about it, so I ran upstairs and we got, I don't know, some hedge clippers or something like that. So I think I'll be able to play tonight. I was at a folk festival up in L.A. just a while ago, I forget when, and they asked me, "Oh, are you there?" Cool. Well, maybe you'll remember this, see, because they wanted me to play one of these, like, topical song, what do they call them, workshop things. And I didn't want to do it because, you know, it used to be years ago when you had a workshop, you actually could do something like learn something, you know, from somebody or something. You can sit down and talk to them and stuff, but these days workshops are just another name for mini concerts or something. And they stuck a bunch of us on the stage and they call it the topical workshop or something. And I got there and I said, "Oh man, topical. Yeah, I thought it was tropical." So I sang this song. Before I sing the song, I was thinking about it for a while, even before I was going over to like Hawaii and stuff, and because, you know, for years, I live up in the cold part of Massachusetts, and I've been there forever, it seems, and but my wife's from like around here, you know, and she froze for years when we got married and moved back east. And I finally suggested to her one time in the middle of a snowstorm that if she took her sandals off and put some boots on or something. She said, "Yeah, but they don't look right." California girl, you know. But I've been promising her for years, you know, we'd be living in, you know, warm climate, palm trees, stuff like that, you know. And I told her, I said, "Don't worry, you know." And she says, "Well, when are we going to move?" And I said, "We're not moving, it's coming here." And for years, she thought I was just losing it, you know. Until about 2 or 3 years ago, we were watching TV together, and they were talking about the greenhouse effect, you know, and how it's going to warm up the whole world, and the ice caps are going to melt, the ocean's going to rise, swallow Boston and New York, and end up right at our house. And she looked at the TV and looked at me and said, "My God, you're right." So I've been out building a boat dock and stuff. 150 miles from the ocean. Now. Palm trees. We have the first palm tree farm in New England. I'm ready.
Season ended, but the drover would not pay.
You said you went and drunk too much, you're all in debt to me. But the cowboys never put much stock in a thing like a bankrupt law. So we left the bastard's bones to bleach on the range of the buffalo. Yeah. remember when I was younger and started to learn to play myself, I was actually younger than anybody here on the stage, but in those days they had a park out in New York City where I was growing up. Well, a New York version of a park, and it was like a big cement slab out between the buildings. And if the weather was nice on a Sunday afternoon, you could go out there, and there'd be all these people standing around just in clumps and herds, groups of people just playing music, you know. And famous people, too. Like even Bill Monroe I saw out there one day. And I remember getting so excited to see Bill Monroe, let alone standing in the park playing for nothing, with all these people clumped around him. And the great thing was, no matter how young or old you were, no matter where you were from or anything, if you had a guitar, banjo, mandolin, fiddle, something, you could sneak up to them and play right along with them, you know. And I did that. Snuck up close to Bill Monroe's playing, ran home, told all my friends, I was just playing with Bill Monroe. And they were saying, who's Bill Monroe? Bill didn't know I was there either, so it worked itself out perfectly, I'm pretty sure, you know. But I learned some stuff out there in the park. Because in those days, you could go up to people and ask them, you know, say, hey, show me how you're doing that and stuff. And sometimes they'd say, hey, get out of here. But if you bugged them enough, they would take, you know, show you stuff. And musicians were accessible. I remember Sonny Terry and Granny McGee taught me this old song. It wasn't their song, but they used to do it a lot, and they used to show me stuff every once in a while. So here's an old blues that goes something like this.
Thank you.
doing some of those old things. Every once in a while, you know, do something. Here's a new one. Well, new for me, which means sometime in the last 5 years. And I wrote this, actually, yeah, I don't even know now how many years ago it was. Wrote it before the war in the Gulf was getting thought about. And wrote it because I noticed as time was going by, things was happening, you know, like people come up and sometimes interviewers from TV and radio and newspapers say, Arlo, what's, you know, give me your take on. And I don't know nothing, you know, I never did, never claimed to know anything. But somehow, if you survive, you know, and if you've got a good imagination, you can make up history so that it sounds plausible. I think most people do that without realizing it, and that's why people are unhappy most of the time. They don't realize how talented they are when it comes to creating their own history. So anyway, I noticed time was going by and things was happening, and the one thing I noticed that as time was going by, more and more people that at one time were out with each other seemed to be getting together on things, and sometimes people who were together on something ended up divided later on, and you know, as time goes by. And I thought, boy, that's kind of weird, you know. Anyway, here's a song that has very little to do with that. This is an observation of mine. I think it comes from the fact that, you know, I write a newsletter still, and some people subscribers. Anyway, so I got a letter from this kid a while ago, about, I don't know, 6 months, 8 months ago, whenever it was. Said, "Dear Arlo, I like your stuff, get your newsletter. I mean, I'm learning how to play guitar, I'm 11 years old, and one thing bothers me, though." He says, "Why don't you get a haircut?" And I thought, oh man, are we going through this again? I don't want to go through this another, you know, again. So I decided to straighten him out, you know, and so I wrote him right back. I said, "Dear kid, years ago, I stopped thinking one time, and I noticed that I wasn't thinking, you know, because I had stopped. And the problem was that because I had stopped thinking, I couldn't think of how to start thinking again. It seemed like all the thoughts in my head just came out and turned into hair." As if I still got hopes and dreams that someday, you know, if it doesn't fall out or something, they'll go back in. I'll have all them thoughts again. Said, under the circumstances, if you was me, would you cut your hair? Yes, ma'am, in the back there. Which means he's still obviously capable of thinking about it. More power to him. I think about things every once in a while. Here's a song, like I said, I wrote for some friends a few years ago now. It's outdated, but it's also overdue at the same time. Here's a, I think it holds up. It goes up. Thank you. didn't record that for years, since I wrote it a few years ago. My family put out a record, just came out this week. I know some of you already got it. We've got bunches of them. And it was nice because years ago I was part of a collection of people that was sort of simultaneously dropped from Warner Brothers. I was in very good company. Bonnie Raitt and Gordon Lightfoot and some other fabulous people. And anyway, we started our own company years ago just because, well, no one else would. And put our stuff out, you know. And we started making some records. And I made, I think, the record I'm most proud of is the last one we made. It was a record we did with Pete Seeger one night this last summer. Man, 64, 65 years, 75 years old, I think, coming up in a month or two. And he's just, he's the same. He's so weird. His voice is getting a little shaky and stuff, you know. And he didn't want to make a record. And I said, Pete, you got to do it. And he said, well, I don't know. My voice is getting a little shaky. And I said, Pete, no one ever came to hear your voice. Didn't matter. They come because, you know, who you are, what you mean, stuff like that. So, sounds great. Anyway, so, make one other record with Pete one time with Holly Nearer and Ronnie Gilbert, a record called Heart. And this is one of the songs that we recorded on that thing, which is kind of nice. Go something like that. We'll be right back. one song here and then take a little break. And this is one of my favorite songs. I've been doing this song for a while. And I know a lot of people have heard me tell this story, but I want to tell it again anyway. Only because earlier tonight, I was on the TV. You were here, but I was here too, but I was on the TV at the same time. And it was cool. I was watching it. It was wild. We were doing a Bob Dylan song on the TV, and you didn't tape it? I did, and I watched it too. It was a good one. It'll be on you. Anyway, we did a great sort of rap version of, I joined his band, not as Arlo, but as this other guy, and I joined a band, and they say that, you know, they don't want me in the band because they want the music that was, you know, sort of written after I'd already gotten old. So I tell them, I say, you know, you think a lot of stuff is new, man, but it's not, you know. And I say to them, I ask them, who do you think wrote the first rap song, you know? And they're going like, Grandmaster Flash. I'm going through everybody, you know. It's Bob Dylan wrote the first rap song. And they look at me. And then we do a sort of rap version of Subterranean Homesick Blues. Bob's going to be really sorry he let me do the song on TV. But I love doing some of his stuff. He's written some fine songs. Probably the last one we'll ever get permission to record. But it was fun anyway. I won't do that one now because I don't have this red jacket that I don't have to sing it in. Cool rap song. Anyway, I'm going to do this other one and just take a break here because I'm going to know I'm having a bad hair first hour. It was all right until I came down the stairs, you know. Oh, yeah, the story, right. See, no, not that story. I'm telling you stories that aren't recorded yet. Did I record this one? No. Well, maybe I did. But that's the reason I record them, so that I don't have to keep telling them, see? Because otherwise, just be up here telling stories, you know, made longer than we have, you know. And so the good ones we record, and the bad ones I tell you. Until they get good, then we record them and like that. If you want to hear good stories, you can buy records. Otherwise, you're just a rehearsal for a record. That's the only way you can think of stuff is if you try it on people, unsuspecting. Well, now, that's out the window. So here I was in Tucson, Arizona years ago. First time I was actually ever in Tucson, 18 years ago or something like that. Actually, before I even left, I got a phone call from the Tucson newspaper. They called me up and said, Arlo, you're coming to Tucson. I said, yeah. And they said, do you realize that Bob Dylan's going to be playing in town the same night as you? Why would anybody come here to you? Well, I couldn't think of nothing either. So I just told him, I said, well, if people really want to go hear some good old Bob Dylan songs, they probably have to come hear me. They printed it. Didn't expect him to print it. Just being a smartass on the phone, you know. I figured it was a dumb question, you know. So we get to Tucson, and there's lines around the block at our show that night. I'm sitting in the dressing room with my Bob Dylan songbook. Realizing I don't know that many Bob Dylan songs. So I always keep a few around. one of my favorite ones that I recorded this years and years ago. And what's something like this. Thank you.
I don't wanna dance.
wrote this song, you know, because it seems as if it was just 25 years ago. I remember I was just out of school and I was riding my bike. I was going down a mountain road, doing 150 miles an hour, playing my guitar. On one side of the mountain road there was a mountain, and on the other side there was nothing, just a cliff in the air. I wasn't paying attention, I was just going down the road, you know, and all of a sudden by accident, a string broke off of my guitar. Broke right there, went flying across the road that way, wrapped itself around the yield sign. Well, the sign didn't break, it didn't come out the ground. The string didn't break, it stayed wrapped around the sign. Stayed in the other end of my guitar. I held on to my guitar with one hand. Held on to my bike with the other one. Made a sharp turn off the road. Luckily, that didn't go into the mountain. I just went over the cliff. I was doing 150 miles an hour sideways and 500 feet down at the same time, looking for the cops. I knew it was illegal. I also knew that that was it. I knew I didn't have long to live in the world, and in my last remaining seconds in the world, I knew it'd be my obligation to write one last farewell song to the world. Took out a piece of paper, pulled out a pen. Sat back and thought a while, but I don't know, nothing come to me, you know, it's like writer's block or something. So I looked up for inspiration. And there in the sky, burning in flames across the clouds, was these very words. I don't want to tickle. Just want to ride on my motorcycle. I don't want to tickle, I'd rather ride on my motorcycle. And I don't want to die, just want to ride on my motorcycle. I knew it wasn't the most brilliant, but I hoped it wasn't going to be the most brilliant song I ever got to write. I didn't have time to change it, so just wrote it down, learned it right away. The most amazing thing was that I didn't die. And I remember I didn't die because it was right after that I started playing in these little folk clubs all across the country. Actually, I wasn't even playing in them. I was just going in them with my guitar so I could get in for free or something, you know. And I'd walk in and sit down. And if somebody who was supposed to be playing didn't show up, or got drunk or sick or crazy or something, they'd look at me and say, "Hey Arlo, why don't you come on up here and sing something, you know, until we can find somebody good." I'd get up there. And this would be one of the few songs I knew. So I'd start singing this song, feeling stupid, embarrassed, ashamed of myself. People were looking at each other like, "We paid for that song." So I started talking in the middle of the song, hoping that I could talk my way out of singing that stupid chorus again. As time went by, the song got longer and longer, till pretty soon I could start this song on one coast and finish it 3 weeks later on the other coast. That's when I quit singing it. Time went by. Years. Decades went by. I never thought I'd sing the song again, till about 2 or 3 years ago, when I discovered that they were studying the lyrics to this song in colleges and universities around the country. No wonder we're in trouble! I don't care. I feel good now. It's okay to be stupid now. Sometimes it's even smart. So now I can sing with pride in my heart. I don't want to pick. Just want to ride on a motorcycle. And I don't want to pick. Cause I'd rather ride on my motorcycle. And I don't want to die. Just want to ride on a motorcycle.
Thank you.
think that was sort of keeping to the spirit of the thing, aside from the fact that you can't really sort of recreate these events. Although I did have an idea years ago, you know, to get somebody like Coca-Cola to sponsor the whole thing, make it free, just call it the real thing. But nobody took me up on that. And nevertheless, I got together with some of the guys just actually a few weeks ago up in San Francisco, raising some money for some folks up there. And it was nice seeing everybody, you know. Nice seeing Country Joe and Wavy Gravy and some of those guys. And even though I'm not going to show up at whatever they got going, it still doesn't feel right or something, you know. But for those of you who wouldn't have gone anyway, here's an old song.
Laws we can
get rid of, you know, and loosen it up a little bit. Getting harder to tell criminals and outlaws and regular people anyway. If you'll get around the children, this story I will tell about a pretty boy called an outlaw. Oklahoma, was in the town to show me on a Saturday afternoon. His wife beside him in his wagon. It's in the town near road. There a deputy sheriff approached them in a manner rather rude, using vulgar words of language, and his wife she overheard. And in the fight that followed, he laid that deputy down. He took to the trees and the timbers, and he lived a life of shame. Every crime in Oklahoma was added to his name. He took to the trees and the timbers on the Canadian River shore, but the outlaw found a welcome at any farmer's door. There's many a stuck farmer, you know the same old story told, how the outlaw paid their mortgage and saved them a little home. Others tell you and underneath his napkin left a $1,000 bill. It was an Oklahoma City, you know, it was on a Christmas day. There come a whole car load of groceries with a letter that did say, say that I'm an outlaw, yes, you say that I'm a thief. Well, here's a Christmas dinner over the family's on relief. You know, it's through this world I've read the book. I've seen lots of funny men. Some will rob you with a six gun, and some with a fountain pen. But it's through the life you drive a family from their home. Oh, this is a note or a book. See you too. Can't read the rest. Used to be able to read. At that distance. I would read it up there. That's how it goes. I got all these song lists around, and they're all from years ago, you know. Don't know what to say anymore. You know, back around 1970, 71, sometime like that, I was playing up in a bar in Chicago one night, and after the show, some place like this, a lot smaller. And after the show, the owner of the place come over to me and says, hey, Arlo, a friend of mine's here, wants to play you a song. I said, oh, come on, yeah, I don't want to hear no songs. I hate songs. Don't like my own songs, unless I listen to other people's songs. Everybody thinks there was a cosmic universal anthem song of the month club song. And I was going on and on and on, you know. And around the corner comes this little guy, and he's just standing there looking at me, smiling. He says, Arlo, I just want to sing you one song. I says, okay, I tell you what, buy me a beer. I'll sit here and drink you. And as long as it lasts, You can do whatever you want. He says, that sounds like a good deal. I says, it does. Turned out to be one of the finer years of my life. Turns out this guy wrote a lot of great songs. His name was Steve Goodman. He passed away some years ago. Boy, he wrote some great songs. He's a great human being. This is the song he sang it in.
Good night!
when I first made some money, which was also the last time, I took all of my Alice's restaurant money and I went up and I bought a whole farm up in New England. Seemed like a right thing to do.
to make a heaven out of this earth.
Thank you.
subject alone. She used three simple words and she brought it all home.
Going on, not just where we are, but all around, you know. That's the one great great thing about being a singer. You go and you get to see what's going on in other places. As a matter of fact, I remember when the first night we got it, I couldn't believe it, we got it. And I was in there all by myself. I was mopping up the floor, you know. Just like, you know, when you get a new car, you start washing it or something. I was all by myself. I heard a knock at the door. And I looked over, and it was a local preacher standing there. It was a glass door, so I couldn't run away or nothing. And I let him in. He said, "Arlo, I just stopped by to see what it is you're doing here." I said, "Oh, not doing much, just mopping up the floor." He said, "No, Arlo, what are you doing here?" I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Arlo, what kind of church is this anyhow?" No one had asked me before, so I didn't know what to say. You know, I mean, I stood there thinking about it, and I said, "Well, it's a bring your own God church." He didn't want to smile. But you could see a little smile spreading across his face, didn't you? He said, "Arlo, I never heard of a church like that." I said, "Well, me neither, but you asked." But when you think about it, maybe every church is like that. Every temple, mosque, synagogue, church, every standing out there on a hill looking up at the stars is a bring your own God thing. You can't be seeing something that's not inside your own heart to see, you know. No matter where you are. He said, "Well, maybe you're right." I said, "I don't know, it just sounded good to me." Haven't seen him since. But it reminded me of something that my dad used to say. And I thought I'd just let you all know tonight. Tell you a little story my dad used to tell. Because it's feeling nice in here right now, you know what I mean? You can feel it out there. And I love this feeling. I just patiently wait for it. And I just love hanging out in it, you know, not just here, but all around with all kinds of people doing fabulous things in the world. You don't hear about them on TV. You don't see them, you know, you don't hear about them on the radio, the newspapers. But there's fabulous people all over the country doing wonderful, wonderful things. Some of them are here tonight, and I know some of them, too. And they don't get famous doing it. They don't get rich. But something just, it feels like this. Imagine feeling like this all the time. What an amazing thing. But more and more people start feeling good. It just sort of spreads around, and everybody sort of becomes part of that one big feeling, that one big family that my dad used to think about and talk about years ago. He was convinced that there was just one family all around the world. And if you read the newspapers, look at the TV, you can get awful depressed about the state that family's in right now. Anyway, here's a story he used to tell. The story of the two rabbits. One day the two rabbits was out in the woods. Mama rabbit and Papa rabbit. They're just eating, munching away on things. The wind kicked up, and all of a sudden, the rabbits heard the sound of dogs off in the distance. And they looked up and they looked around. They didn't see nothing. The wind died down, they just went back to eating, but now they was paying attention. And after a little while, the sound of the dogs got louder. Pretty soon it got so loud, the rabbits started looking around again. And they looked up through the trees, and on a far hill, they could see a whole bunch of dogs just coming right in their direction. It just so happened at the same time that the rabbits stood up there looking, the dogs looked down and saw the two rabbits. And all of a sudden, a bunch of dogs got very happy. Tails started going, feet started running, just smiling, they were drooling, barking, happy, yelping dogs. And they started running after the rabbits. And when the rabbits saw the dogs coming, they just bolted. And they took off, and they started running around this way, that way, around the trees, and over the rocks, and through the shrubs. No matter where they went, no matter how quick they was, the dogs kept getting closer and closer until finally the dogs was just about on top of them. The rabbits started getting tired. But with the last bit of energy, they ducked into the hollow of a log. And then the next instant, the dogs was all over the log. They couldn't get in, but they was making a lot of noise out there. Inside the log, above all the noise, Mama Rabbit looked at the Papa Rabbit. She said, "Papa, I don't think we're getting out of here alive. But the Piper Rabbit just smiled. He said, that's all right. We'll just stay here till we outnumber them. Especially when people say, Arlo, where have you been for the last 20 years? I tell them that story. Just been home, breeding. Now my own kids are starting to have kids. And they're not leaving home either. Keep saying, don't you want to go out and get your own place and come and go when you want, eat what you want, and watch what you want on TV? I can watch Star Trek and stuff, you know. Nobody's going anywhere. Turning out to be more like the Waltons than I thought it was gonna. And I know I'm not alone. I'm not alone around the world, because as the world keeps getting smaller and smaller, well, it's just more people gotta stick around with each other. People get closer and closer. When you think about it, if the world was fine, nobody got sick, everybody had a house, everybody had nice, convenient spouses, happy kids, BMW in every driveway. Plenty of money. Nobody ever went without anything. You could have whatever. I mean, imagine a world like that. You'd have to go a hell of a long way out of your way to improve it on any and all. I mean, you'd have to go so far out of your way to make a difference, it wouldn't be worth it. But in a world that sucks, like this one, you don't have to do very much at all. There's never been a time in the history of the world where you could do so little and have it mean so much to so many people. This might be the world we've been asking for all this time. What a scary thought. Anyway, I thought I'd leave you with that. Scary thought. Just thank you for coming and being here and hanging out with us, feeling this. I just wanted to say thanks to the guys in the band. I don't know if they introduced themselves or not. Let me take a moment to do it. Tim Sears over on the lead guitar over there. Darren Todd on the bass. Polly Bobby McConnell on the drums behind me. Jason Webby Webster on the lead vocal and the guitar. My son Abe Guthrie on the far keyboard over there. You don't even have to believe anything I'm telling you. It's just a feeling now, you know? If you don't know the words, just mumble your way through. Trust me, I make a living doing it. Pete Seeger's the one that taught me you don't even have to know the tune. He said you just pick a note and you slide around a while till it feels good. I mean, the worst that can happen is somebody sitting next to you and go, hey, you got it out. That's what these songs are for. Help me out if you know.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
people are looking at me. The lights are in your eyes, you know. Because I learned a tune by sight. Looks all right. I've just been waiting to find out something, and I just found out. So, I heard some groans before this journey. I couldn't tell because I can't see, you know. But somewhere out here, we were talking about the show earlier that you missed, the one on TV. And so I just found out. If you stick around, we'll show it up on the screen if you want to hang out. Leaving before, so that you don't say, "Oh man, that was not worth it." If you want to see it, it's an hour long or something like that, and but they'll show it. Okay, here we go. Let's do this old song here, and then we'll pack up. And those of you who want to hang out, welcome to that.
Feeling well. tells me I have somewhere to go. But I look and try.